So, as I have already explained, what is psychology of programming is basically where we are trying to understand how a programmer thinks when they are into programming or writing code. Okay. So it involves actually four things here. How people think, what is the thought process behind it, what is to be done, and how to get this done is something that programmer or the person will do. Second thing is how people learn out of it, like how the programmer will learn something out of doing the programming. Problem solving is the third part, where the programmer will think about how to solve this program. And last aspect of it is a social and collaborative aspects to programming. So let's get into the first topic about how people think. So it is very important for a programmer or the person to understand the problem statement, what it is about. And once he's aware about what the problem statement is, it is his next step to break it down into smaller parts to make it easy for him to understand how to proceed with it. And going ahead, it is very important to represent the problem in mind so that the problem solving actually happens inside of the mind. And you can actually think about how to come up with solutions when you actually have the problem in mind and you keep on thinking about it. And lastly, the thinking process ends up with coming up with the solution to it. This is everything. This, all these things are actually happening inside of the brain of the programmer, is what psychology of programming tells about. The next thing is how do people learn? So active learning is something that happens when you are actively participating in it and you learn out of it. So you do programming and then you learn out of it. Like this is happens eventually. Practicing, of course, when you do coding back and forth multiple times, learn new technology, practice it, it will, of course, help you learn it more. Making mistake, of course, we do make mistakes a lot of time when we program, we fail actually, and we learn out of it. This is the third aspect. And lastly, we need to do as a programmer is ask for help. This can be one-to-one help from your fellow employees, or it can be also online help where you actually go into platforms like Stack Overflow or ChatGPT or something like that, and you ask for help. And you should never hesitate to actually ask for help when you are stuck with something, because you'll, of course, come up with a better solution when you go ahead and ask someone about some problem statement or a solution which you're looking for. So this is also comes in the process of learning. Next comes how to solve the problem. So how a programmer will solve the problem is, firstly, again, understanding the problem, what it is about, is very important. So keeping track of is the problem about, and continuously evaluating is something that a programmer does to solve the problem. Brainstorming, again, brainstorming is mostly used when it is a group activity, but then again, I'm using it here because even when you are doing it solo and you think about different solutions, you can call it brainstorming, because you come up with different solutions. Of course, you have like 2 to 3 solutions that can be implemented on certain situations. So this is where you brainstorm about all the solutions that you have. Then go ahead and evaluate it, like how the particular solution will actually help you. And like choose one out of all the solutions that you have brainstormed. And then going ahead with that one solution and try to implement it. So you can see like how the chronology is basically understanding the problem, brainstorming the solution, evaluating, and then implementing the solution. It is very straightforward, nothing very complex to. And then finally come up with the test for the solutions that you have come up with. So basically, this is where we call it the first level testing from the developer side. So you basically test whatever you have implemented and see if it is working as expected. So that basically sums up how a programmer will solve the problem. Next thing is the last thing here is the collaborative aspect of it, and how actually to socialize the this overall thing of programming. And we call programming as a social activity because, of course, we do a lot of activities online, that is like taking help from the open source and other stuff. So we usually call it as a social activity. Also, the fact that when you have something developed from your side, you will, of course, want to share it with the world. So it can be also considered as a social activity because you're sharing with the public. So programming, in a way, is considered as a social activity. Online communities, again, addition to the first point. So online communities, meaning we have like forums and other stuffs. We join communities, Stack Overflow and other stuffs where we actually go ahead and see if we can get help or we can help someone. So this is the second part of the social aspect to it. And collaborative programming, again, is addition to the both points, which I said, putting up your problems and solutions online on a place where people can actually see and see the solutions to it, what you have implemented and other stuff, and also ask questions. So it becomes a collaboration if you see group, like a group activity. Of course, we are working in a pod structure, but then there are other people also working on the same technology, expecting people to help and also provide solutions when they are stuck. So this is something that comes under collaborative programming. And now I see that I have explained the four aspects of it. Let's see why it is important. It is very important to design a better environment with the technologies that we have. So let's say we decide on to, so let's say now I join in as a fresher and I decide to choose a technology to go ahead. So I cannot choose 10 different technologies to learn together. I would of course want to learn one thing first, that is like a basis of something that would help me strengthen up my basis for that particular technology, and then go ahead and implement and help myself to learn other technologies as well. The importance here is to get into such a better environment for a particular programming language and go ahead with it. Next is developing more effective teaching methods for programming. So again, there should be some way or other for someone to learn how to program so that there are multiple people together working on something, and then they can effectively do something like a teaching method where, so you can consider this PDC or this technical session to be a effective method to teach how people can start programming. So it is very important to escalate something from one person to other. So this is one point I felt was important here. Making programming a more accessible to everyone is something very important, like sharing work and the solutions and your problems and whatever you have implemented, keeping it online. If it is not in a bond with the client or something like that, you can of course keep it online, or maybe share in form of an article or some blog post, so that it is accessible to everyone and people can actually learn about it. So recently you can say I was learning something about in-app purchases, and I felt that the library which I was using was not used by a lot of people. There were less contributions towards that particular library. So what happened was I was trying to see if there are people who actually implemented it, and like I had something to refer from. So I saw a blog post college students had posted somewhere, and it was their final year project. So I found it so helpful, it being written by us college students, but then it was very effective for me. I took examples from there and I was able to implement the in-app purchases for my app. It's very important here that whatever you have, like you have the knowledge base, it is better to make it accessible to other people so that other people also come across the technologies and other stuff when it comes to programming. I think we should move ahead with talking about how to make it accessible. Two things that people do follow is using simpler and clear and consistent language when trying to program. Okay. And second point is where you use clear and concise instructions, like in form of comments. So let's say when I'm writing a program and I know that maybe someday or the other, some other developer will be working on the on this project. So I should make sure that whatever code I have written is very simple and clear enough, being it in any language, and using a consistent and understandable language throughout the project, so that it remains very consistent for him to understand as well, for the other person who is joining. Next thing is using examples and illustrations to help explain concepts. So let's say the one thing that I can take an example of is when trying to implement something, let's say a very complex, let's say if I'm trying to implement a very complex feature in an app, What I would do is take example from something, and I try to see if I can. So using loops and all, so it is better to use the consistency should be such that you use the writing of the code should be such that it should be in such a explanatory way that you should use examples as code that can be used as different components throughout the project. It becomes more simpler for people to understand. So providing opportunities for practice and feedback is something that I was thinking of adding in here, because feedback is something that we must receive with respect to maybe a constructive feedback, with respect to understanding how things went well when I developed something and how I can improve, making it easy for people to ask for help. So let's say we have platforms like Stack Overflow. I'm taking example of Stack Overflow is because past few years I've been very busy on this Stack Overflow, checking for solutions and other stuff. Now maybe ChatGPT has come into picture, but then it was just Stack Overflow helping me out with all the issues that I had. It is of course very important for someone to put in the solutions to things or the implementations online so that it is easily accessible for people, and people can actually ask questions and take help from the resources that are available online. So as a programmer, I will always think about publishing my stuff online. Let's say I am an app developer. So of course I would want my app to be accessible to everyone. So I would put the app online. I would make it, make a marketing website to it so that to market my app. So I would do such things. I would add online courses, how to do in a particular technology or a tech stack, how to do that as a programmer. I think psychology of programming involves all these points, and making it accessible to people is something that is one thought process that is in programmers' mind. As I was talking about examples, let's see if we can take example from science and see if we can compare programming with scientific methods. So let's say there are four things here we can see is observation, theory, hypothesis, and experiment. So let's say there's one guy who sees that an apple is falling from the tree. You all know who the guy is, right? So let's say it was his observation that, so let's say it was his observation that the apple is falling, right? He saw that it was falling from the tree. So this was his observation. So this is scientific method, how a scientist would, let's say someone who is a scientist would classify things into. The first thing that he would do is observe that something is happening. Next thing what he would do is apply a theory to it. So let's say, what is the theory of behind apple falling from the tree? So it is like, basically it is a force that must be causing the apple to fall from the tree. Or there can be six theories. I'm just talking about one here. So there can be six theories. What can make the apple fall? Let's say, Mohammed, you can give any example of something that comes from a stable position to down. So let's say, what are the factors that would make something fall down? So if I say a force, so force can be what? Okay, gravity. So gravity is the hypothesis that I will apply. Okay, so let's say, I will say the apple shall fall because there is something that is putting it down, or it is, yes, the weight is another theory to it. So let's say hypothesis is something that I would do the next step, classifying it, why it should fall, and how I know that the apple shall fall. Okay. And the last thing that I do is I do an experiment. Let's see if it actually falls. And I see that I hold the apple in my hand and I let it fall down. So it does fall down. So I see that, okay, the experiment works. So there is something that is happening. So this is, I can see, the scientific method that Newton applied for the classifying this into letting the example of gravity to people for the people to understand, take observation, theory, hypothesis, and experiment. So he will of course say it falls, there is force to it, and let's call it gravity that makes it fall. Okay. How will I compare this with programming is, of course, what I will do as a programmer is, first thing that I'll do is observe, see what can be done, apply theory to it, put hypothesis in experiment.